Welcome to my talk. I'm Giustina Vietri, postdoc at the Institute of Space Astrophysics and Cosmic Physics in Milano. I will talk about Agean activity and host galaxy properties in Vipers and VVDS surveys. This project is inserted in the framework of Agean galaxy coevolution. Agean feedback was invoked to reproduce the observed properties of galaxies. Here, an example for the luminosity function. The shape of the observed luminosity function of galaxies and that of scaled halo's mass function, which is the predicted one, are different. The assumption that the stellar mass follows the halo mass leads to unseen many small galaxies and too many big, extremely bright galaxies. Supernova feedback was invoked to reproduce the faint end of the luminosity function. For the bright end, the field of supernova winds in reproducing the slope have required a different mechanism, the Agean feedback. This feedback acts through outflows which are capable of affecting the cold gas reservoir by removing the gas or preventing it to form new stars. This leads to the regulation of star formation or quenching of star formation. Despite the different size scales involved, a small fraction of AGN radiative output is enough to unbind the galactic bulge. So supermassive black holes can regulate galaxy evolution, but also their own growth. We aim at investigating the relation between the AGN and host galaxies at intermediate redshift. So we collected data from Vipers and VVDS surveys. Vipers was designed to sample galaxies at redshift range from 0.5 up to 1.2 within two different fields from the Canada, France, White Telescope Legacy Service White, and with a covering area of 24 square degree and a magnitude limit of 22.5. VVDS was designed to sample galaxies at redshift range from 0 up to 6.7 within three different complementary surveys, wide, deep, and ultra deep, with different covering areas and magnitude limits. Both surveys were observed with the VMOS spectrograph with low resolution mode. And here an example of a spectrum with emission lines of interest, such as oxygen 2, H beta, and the oxygen 3 doublet. We used the blue diagram from La Marelle 2010 to discriminate between different sources of ionization, such as AGN, liners, subforming. And there is also an area of for composite subforming at AGN. This diagram uses the equivalent width ratios of O3 over H beta and O2 over H beta. So we found a sample of 812 type 2 AGN at redshift range of 0.5 up to 0.9. We derived stellar masses through spectral energy distribution fitting, and we, by using the Seagal code, we collect the multiband photometry and we use both the galaxy agent templates. So we assume a delayed star formation history, and we use the library of Grusual and Charlot 2003. We use the Calzetti law for the dust extinction and a model of reprocessed emission in the infrared from the dust. For the AGN template, we use the model of Fritz et al. 2006, which include both accretion disk and torus components. We derive stellar masses in the range of 10 to the 8 up to 10 to 12 solar masses. Here, you can see the distribution of stellar masses in different redshift bins. Star formation rates were derived using the oxygen 2 emission line, which is commonly used for star forming galaxies as star formation rate indicators at this redshift. So we followed Silverman et al. 2009, which using SDSS AGN, demonstrating that the luminosity ratio of O2 over O3 decreases at increasing luminosities. And the slope that describes this relation is flatter for type 2 SDSS, here represented in this plot as a solid line, then type 1 AGN, here represented as dashed line. And this difference is explained by an additional component to the tree due to ongoing star formation. So our target here in blue show a similar slope as type 2 SDSS and also enhanced values of the luminosity ratio of O2 over O3. We also, and this further justify the O2 as a saturation rate indicator in our case. So we also subtract a possible AGN contribution to the O2, and we assume that oxygen 3 is AGN dominated. And we follow Zhuang et al. 2019, which found a fairly constant ratio between O2 over O3 for the AGN contribution. So we subtract this fraction of emission and derive saturation rate from the calibration of Qiuli et al. 2004. We derive saturation rate in the range of 0.0138 solar masses per year. So we compare for our target the star formation rate as a function of stellar mass with the tight correlation between the star formation rate and stellar mass typical of star-forming galaxies, the so-called main sequence. And we adopted the main sequence from Schreiber et al. 2015, here represented as a solid line along with its scatter here as dashed lines. The 49% of our target are on and above the mean sequence. And at stellar masses larger than 10 to the 10 solar mass, almost all sources are below the mean sequence. We compared our target with optically selected AGN from the Cosmos sample of Buongiorno et al. 2012, which have a similar redshift range of our target. And they span a similar range also in the star formation rate and the stellar masses. Contours are the BOS TET2 AGN from Thomas 2013. And also they have a similar redshift range of our target, but they probed the high massive end of the stellar mass distribution. So by looking at this bin of stellar mass, they have a similar star formation rate as our target. So we compare the offset from the mean sequence with oxygen 3 luminosity, which can be considered as a proxy of AGN power. And here in this plot, our data are color coding as a function of stellar mass. And as you can see, a type 2 AGN show a dependence of star formation rate as a function of stellar mass. And there is a clear bimodality with two populations at a fixed AGN power. Massive type 2 AGN hosts show a larger offset from the main sequence than low mass AGN hosts. So we call these two populations as high star forming and low star forming. Moreover, there is a positive correlation between the main sequence offset and the AGN power. At increasing luminosity, the AGN hosts tend to have higher star formation rate. And this could reflect the availability of the gas, which is enough to sustain star formation and both feed the supermassive black hole. So about 51% of our AGN show a reduced level of star formation rate than expected. And this could be due to ongoing quenching. So we look for feedback in action by looking at the line profile of the oxygen tree, since winds are usually traced by the asymmetrical O3 line profile. So we stacked the spectra of the high star forming and low star forming populations in different oxygen tree luminosity. And for the high star forming sample, we found a similar oxygen tree profile. This could be due to low sigma signal to noise ratio or to the resolution or to absence of outflows. For the low star forming sample, at tight luminosity, they show blue wings. And this could be due to the presence of outflows traced by the ionized gas. We also derived the black hole mass and Eddington ratio for these two populations by using an indirect method following Barone et al. 2019. Black hole mass depends on continuum luminosity and the width of a broad emission line. We derived the full width of this broad emission line by using the luminosity ratios of oxygen 3 over H beta. And the continuum luminosity was derived from the bolometric luminosity by assuming a bolometric correction factor for the oxygen 3 luminosity. So we derive black hole mass in the range of 10 to the 7 up to 10 to the 10 solar masses. And the Eddington ratio, which is indicative of accretion process of the AGN, and is proportional to the ratio of bolometric luminosity and black hole mass, with a rate value in the range of 10 to the minus 3 up to 0.5. So for these two populations, as you can see here, the distribution of Eddington ratio and black hole mass for the low star forming galaxies in green, they showed a lower Eddington ratio and higher black hole mass than high star forming. And these differences indicate a difference in terms of AGN activity for both populations. Furthermore, for the low star forming sample, it could be that they are in a final decay of AGN activity. So I leave here with my conclusion, and thank you for your attention.